The next item of business is consideration of business motion 14246 in the name of Jamie Hepburn on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau on changes to business. Any member who wishes to speak to the motion should press their request to speak button now. And I call on Jamie Hepburn to move the motion.
Move, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Minister. No member has asked to speak to the motion. Therefore, the question is that motion 14246 be agreed. Are we all agreed? The motion is therefore agreed. The next item of business is topical questions. And at question number one, I call Alexander Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what assessment it has made of the potential impact on the cultural sector and livelihoods of the reported closure of Creative Scotland's Open Fund for individuals due to budgetary constraints.
Cabinet Secretary Angus Robertson.
Thank you, and with your permission, Presiding Officer, I'd like to begin by mentioning today's memorial service for Ewan MacDonald, who died recently from motor neuron disease. Ewan lived for 20 years with MND. He established the Ewan MacDonald Centre for Motor Neuron Disease Research in partnership with the University of Edinburgh, the Voice Bank study which enables people who are at risk of losing their voice through illness to preserve it, and Ewan's guide with his sister Kiki, which is used by disabled people to review, share and discover accessible places to visit. He was inspiration, and I'm sure the whole Chamber extends its condolences to his family today. In answer to Mr. Stewart's topical question, I am well aware of the potential impact of decisions by Creative Scotland on the Open Fund for individuals. I'd like to extend my thanks to the many people in the culture and arts sector in particular who've been in touch to underscore how important the fund is. And I'd also like to give them and members of the Scottish Parliament the assurance that I'm working extremely hard with colleagues across government to make sure that the appropriate funding decisions are made to sustain and support the culture and arts sector. Announcements are set to follow on the pre-budget fiscal update, and the government remains committed to increasing financial support to culture and the arts.
Alexander Stewart.
Can I associate myself and my party with the comments by the Cabinet Secretary regarding Ewan MacDonald? I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that response. More than 170 artists have warned in an open letter that cultural catastrophe is in progress and job losses in the sector are already taking place. The situation is dire, and it is clear that urgent and substantial action is required and needed. How do you justify abandoning a sector which sustains over 80,000 jobs and contributes more than £5 billion to the economy? And can I ask the Cabinet Secretary if he has yet met with Creative Scotland or other organisations to listen to the concerns they have expressed?
Cabinet Secretary.
I think the concerns have been raised by the creative sector rather than Creative Scotland itself, but I'm content to meet with any members of the culture or the arts sector, many of whom have written to me about this very issue. I have to say it is disappointing that Creative Scotland took the decision that it did in relation to the Open Fund before the Scottish Government, as is normal practice, could complete due diligence to release funding. The Scottish Government continues to provide significant funding to Creative Scotland each year, and it will continue to do so. Members will recognise my commitment, oft stated in this chamber, to increasing funding for the culture and arts sector, and I look forward to updating colleagues on that shortly.
Alexander Stewart.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary. It's hard to believe that only 11 months ago, the SNP conference, the then First Minister, announced a huge vote of confidence in the future of the cultural sector. Yet despite the recent success of the Edinburgh Fringe Festival, the announcement of the closure of the Creative Scotland's Open Fund for individuals is nothing short of a betrayal for these artists and cultural workers who have made that such success possible. Cabinet Secretary, how will you entrust and rebuild trust in a sector that has been consistently let down?
Always through the chair, please, Cabinet Secretary.
Indeed. Well, firstly, can I make the point again that I and the government is committed to increasing funding for culture. And I think he is aware that that stands in contrast to the outgoing UK Conservative government and the incoming Labour government cutting culture funding through the Department for Culture, Media and Sport, indeed also cutting culture in Wales by the Welsh Government. I remain committed to securing additional funding for the culture and arts sector because we acknowledge how important it is, and it would be welcome if colleagues from other parties would do everything that they can to join the cultural and arts community. Myself and colleagues in government are doing everything that we can to get the appropriate funding in place as quickly as possible to make sure that not only is the sector safeguarded and sustained, but can thrive in the future.
Thank you. We have much interest, so concise questions and responses appreciated. I call Emma Roddick.
Officer, I've had recent discussions with Eden Court in Inverness, amongst others, about the concern they have about supporting local Highlands and Islands artists without the Open Fund. Could the Cabinet Secretary speak to what support is available to such people, particularly given they've lost opportunities through Brexit?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, one of the particular projects that I'm very supportive of is the Culture Collective, which does a lot of good work in the north of Scotland and is supported through funding from the Scottish Government. I'm committed to that, but I'm also committed more generally to making sure that art funds, including the Open Fund, are open for artists to make sure that the cultural sector can thrive. I can give my colleague the assurance that everything is being done in government at the present time to make sure that the funding is safeguarded and is provided as a priority. It's something that I was committed to over a year ago. I remain committed to doing so now and into the future.
Neil Bibby.
I associate myself with the remarks by the Cabinet Secretary about the late Ewan MacDonald. This is a total mess, and Scotland's artists are paying the price for this government's incompetence and poor planning. Angus Robertson talks about the commitments he has given. He gave a gold-plated commitment to the sector to replenish £6.6 million to Creative Scotland, but this funding has yet to transpire. The Open Fund is closed, and as we've heard, the overall lack of certainty has led to some of Scotland's biggest names, including Paolo Nutini and Biffy Clyro, to warn of an impending cultural catastrophe. Given the constant cycle of promises followed by cuts, how can Scotland's arts and culture sector have confidence in their future and anything this Cabinet Secretary says now?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I'll take absolutely no lessons on austerity from the Labour Party when it comes to funding anything. His party in government in the United Kingdom is cutting funding for culture and the arts. This is a fact. This government is increasing funding. I remain committed to doing so, and I hope that he will welcome the good news to come.
Rachel Hamilton.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. After previous uncertainty, the Cabinet Secretary confirmed in an answer to me in November 2023 that the Scottish Government were committed to providing the £6.6 million shortfall funding to Creative Scotland for 24-25. In my response, I described it as a U-turn on a U-turn on a U-turn, and it appears that we have another U-turn, Cabinet Secretary. Cabinet Secretary, can I make a plea to you to be fair, to be transparent and to be open with Scotland's culture and creative sector, because at the moment it's a hokey-cokey.
We'll remind members again to always speak through the chair, Cabinet Secretary.
Well, just very, very briefly, I hope there is universal understanding across the chamber that that Creative Scotland is an arm's-length organisation that makes decisions. It's not for government ministers to dispense largesse to parts of the cultural sector that they particularly support. I do agree that it's important that the funding is in place to make sure that culture can be sustained, safeguarded and thrive. I remain committed to that. I'm continuing to argue for that in government, and I have to say my colleagues are very, very supportive of that, and I hope to be able to update colleagues on that in the near future.
Patrick Harvey.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. In the short term, it's essential that the Cabinet Secretary finds a solution to the closure of the Open Fund, which is causing great concern to all of our constituents. In the longer term, though, I want to come with positive solutions. We've already persuaded Parliament to pass legislation to give councils the power for a visitor levy. We're now making the case for a stadium levy on large, profitable events, again, a way of raising revenue to fund culture and the arts. Does the Cabinet Secretary agree that empowering local government to raise revenue from those who do make significant profits is the most effective way that we can find to solve this problem and generate the funds that are needed?
Cabinet Secretary.
I'm sure the Presiding Officer would wish me to focus my reply in relationship to the Open Fund that I know the Member is very committed to, but he is right to point out that there are other potential income sources. The visitor levy will play an important part of that, and if he has specific suggestions, I am open to hearing them from him and his colleagues.
Philip Cole-Hamilton.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I met last month with the Executive Director of Edinburgh's International Festival. Whilst Edinburgh's International Festival is in large part the jewel in the crown of Scotland's cultural offering, its survival is not inevitable, and its Executive Director, Francesca Hedgie, reminded me that actually a lot of that work is sustained by the smaller arts groups who are funded through the Open Fund. Does the Cabinet Secretary recognise that the 3 million visitors who come to Edinburgh for our festivals don't just stay in Edinburgh, they visit all parts of Scotland? It's vital for our economy. So investing in the arts is actually an investment in our economy.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I think the point of festivals is very well made, and it's not just the tremendous festivals that we have in Edinburgh. We have tremendous festivals in Scotland with Celtic connections and right the length and breadth of Scotland, and that's why the government at the time of the festivals announced a strategic partnership with our festivals across the country to make sure that they can thrive in future. I remain focused absolutely on making sure that the appropriate funding is in place, that Creative Scotland has the funds that it requires to do the job that it needs to do, and the support and assistance from members across the Chamber and the great many people in the arts and culture community who've been in touch in recent weeks to underscore the importance of the Open Fund are extremely persuasive, and I'm doing everything that I can in government to make sure that the appropriate funding is in place.
Michelle Thompson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I note with great interest the comments from the Cabinet Secretary and await with optimism updates in the coming days. However, given this, does he agree with me that perhaps in certain extent this situation has arisen because of a wider financial picture, in that the Scottish Government is waiting with great interest for the UK Government's final budget at the end of October and really won't have its own funding tied down into February 2025? To what extent has that played a part?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, the points that Michelle Thompson makes are well made about the challenges, particularly for colleagues who are having to deal in the first instance with budgetary considerations across the Scottish Government. What I know as the Cabinet Secretary with responsibility for culture is that this government has given a commitment not just to protect culture funding but to increase it, and I remain committed to that, as does the government, and I look forward to updating colleagues on that in the near future.
Thank you. Question number two, Willie Rennie.
To ask the Scottish Government what assessment it has made of its work to tackle the poverty-related educational attainment gap in light of the gap reportedly widening across all school qualifications in the recent exam results.
Cabinet Secretary Jenny Gilruth.
The most recent set of results from Scotland's schools show that for National 5 and higher, the attainment gap has returned to levels broadly comparable with those in 2019, the last comparable year on record due to changes made during the pandemic to qualifications requirements. The results also show record levels of young people achieving technical and vocational qualifications, with an almost 25% increase on the year prior. And there has been an increase in students from the most disadvantaged communities gaining a place in higher education, with a 12% increase this year alone. Notwithstanding, it is clear that the pandemic is continuing to have a lasting impact on our children and young people here and elsewhere in the UK. Responding to this year's results, I convened a meeting with directors of education to focus on improvement and local variation, along with the Chief Examiner and Interim Chief Inspector. It is imperative that government work to drive improvement in our schools post-pandemic. And to that end, I will set out further detail pertaining to the government's response in the coming weeks in relation to qualification reform and school improvement.
Willie Rennie.
The Education Secretary chooses her milestones very carefully. She knows that this government will be measured on its promise made in 2016 to close the poverty-related attainment gap. So 8 years into that promise, how confident is she that that promise will be delivered by 2026?
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank Mr Rennie for his question. I think it is worthwhile pointing out the progress that has been made thus far in relation to closing the gap. I don't take away from some of the challenge, and of course some of that challenge is not of this government's making. But we have seen a narrowing of the gap in Primary 7, for example, in literacy and numeracy in December statistics. We've also seen, though, progress in relation to our young people going on to positive destinations. Since 2009, the attainment gap has narrowed by 60% in that regard. And again, as I intimated in my initial response, we've seen really strong progress this year in terms of widening access, with a 12% increase in university acceptance for those from our poorest communities. I don't take away from the ongoing challenge here, but I do hope that Mr Rennie can recognise that progress. And of course, I would say that the financial context within which the government is operating is also relevant here, because if we continue to see an austerity agenda being pursued by the Westminster government, irrespective of party, that is going to hamper the progress I'm able to make as Education Secretary, because I will have less money at my disposal to make the necessary progress we need to see in closing the gap.
Willie Rennie.
It does seem that the SNP government are focused more on finding excuses than they are on closing the poverty-related attainment gap. She's also incredibly selective with her statistics, and I know we all like to choose our own statistics, but she is going to be measured on the poverty-related attainment gap as set out by the former First Minister in 2016. So what does the Education Secretary say to those thousands of young people from disadvantaged backgrounds who the promise was made to them but has failed to be delivered so far?
Cabinet Secretary.
For his question, he talks about selective use of statistics. And of course, when I was teaching modern studies, we used to talk about being selective in your use of facts. So in my initial response to Mr Rennie, I talked about National 5 and higher. And Mr Rennie might want to look at the results this year for Advanced Air, where we have seen a slight widening of the gap. Why is that the case in relation to that qualification? Because we've seen an increase in relation to the number of students sitting that qualification. I think that's a good thing, because in the past, certainly when I was at school back in Mr Rennie's constituency some time ago now, there was gatekeeping in relation to that qualification. So it used to be in the past that children were essentially told they weren't bright enough to sit that qualification. I don't think that was right, and I think we've now seen a far broader approach to qualification entry, and undoubtedly that will impact in relation to attainment. But we have seen progress in relation to closing the gap. I rehearsed some of the narrative there in relation to our performance at primary 7 level, and of course in terms of positive destinations. But the final point I would make is this, Presiding Officer. Scotland is not an outlier in relation to closing the poverty-related attainment gap. For both A-levels and GCSEs this year, the gap between the highest and the lowest performing regions in England has grown and remains higher than it was before the pandemic. I'm not using this as an excuse to Mr Rennie's point. What I would say is that context in Scotland is felt all over the UK, and the cohort of young people in front of
Cabinet
teachers
Secretary.
Right now have lived through a global pandemic, and we should all be mindful about what that means in relation to their outcomes as a result.
I'm keen to have more members, for more members to have an opportunity to put questions, concise questions and responses. Appreciated. Liam Kerr.
Presiding Officer, 8 years since the promise was made, is the Cabinet Secretary in a position to provide us with a credible written strategic plan that she's working to close the poverty-related attainment gap, or is she making it up as she goes along?
Cabinet Secretary.
I think, as Mr Kerr is well aware, this government plan is the Scottish Attainment Challenge, which has over £1 billion of funding coming to closing the poverty-related attainment gap during this parliamentary session. Well, Mr Kerr doesn't think that's a good idea. I think it's a pretty substantive plan. He should engage with the detail of it if he's interested. Yes. However, if he also listened to my initial response, and I hope he was, I stated very clearly that I will give a written and a fulsome update in relation to qualification reform in the coming weeks, and that will set out a clear trajectory in relation to improvement.
Marodic.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Central to the poverty-related attainment gap is clearly the issue of poverty itself, with thousands of children being pushed into poverty by the austerity agenda, which the Liberal Democrats were central to ushering in. Does the Cabinet Secretary agree that one of the most important things that we can do in improving educational attainment is to eradicate child poverty?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I think the member makes a hugely important point. Of course, what drives the attainment gap is poverty, caused by more than a decade of austerity and brutal cuts, supported by both Labour and the Tories. So children and families are bearing the brunt of Tory cuts to social security and brutal policies like the two-child limit, which of course we now know is supported by Keir Starmer and the Labour Party. We know too, Presiding Officer, that modelling published estimates that Scottish Government policies will keep 100,000 children out of relative poverty in 24-25, with relative poverty levels 10 percentage points lower than they would have otherwise been. But meanwhile, the Tories and Labour are committed to doubling down on austerity, and that impacts on attainment and poverty.
Pam Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Cabinet Secretary said at the weekend she can't raise attainment with fewer teachers, yet teacher numbers will this year be cut. Later this afternoon, it's likely we'll hear of further pressures to local government and school budgets. Far from reforming anything in education, the Cabinet Secretary is putting forward an education bill that essentially achieves very little. So can I ask the Cabinet Secretary, fewer teachers, fewer resources and what's been dubbed as pretty meaningless reform, is this really the plan to raise attainment and close the poverty-related attainment gap?
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank Ms Duncan Glancy for her question, and of course I'm sure she will recognise there was actually an increase in secondary teachers last year. I'm sure she would want to record that fact. And of course in Scotland we have the lowest pupil-teacher ratio, far lower for example than in Labour-run Wales. I'm sure the member would also like to recognise that. And of course I'm sure she would like to recognise that we spend more per pupil in Scotland than any other part of the UK. I'm sure she would also like to recognise that. And of course I'm sure Ms Duncan Glancy would love to recognise that Scottish teachers are the best paid in the UK because of investment from this government. Now the member talks about reform and I look forward to engaging with her in that process to better improve the outcomes for Scotland's children and young people, but I very much hope that she can recognise the inputs from this government in supporting our education system.
And Stephen Kerr.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. What assessment has the Cabinet Secretary made in respect to attainment on the impact of the increasing levels of violence and threat being reported in classrooms on the teaching and learning environment, and what will she do about it?
I thank the Cabinet Secretary. I thank the member for his question. Of course, I know he takes a keen interest in this matter, and I hope he will be attending my statement on the Behaviour Action Plan, which I will give to Parliament later. Today, he'll be aware that we published the Action Plan 2 weeks ago now, and that Action Plan responds to the assessment the government undertook on the impact of behaviour in relation to attainment. That was published in the Behaviour in Scotland Schools research towards the end of last year. So I'd encourage him to engage with that data if he hasn't already done so, and I look forward to engaging with him further in the statement later today.